hope you're all having a lovely Christmas. I'm here to read some work written by children in Greater Manchester, all in aid of a wonderful charity called Wood Street Mission. The first story I have is from Harry Morris, who's 9 years old, and it's called My Christmas Day. Christmas for our family starts at the beginning of December when we put up the Christmas decorations and get our advent calendars. I normally get one with small toys in and one with chocolate. Every weekend in December, me and my sister and my mummy and daddy watch a Christmas film in our Christmas onesies. My favourite is The Santa Claus, but Santa Claus the movie is our family's favourite, so we always watch that one just before Christmas. My mummy always plays Christmas songs in the car too. On Christmas morning, me and my sister open presents from mummy and daddy and from Father Christmas. And then my grandma and granddad Sean come with my uncle Si and we exchange more presents. After that, we go to Nana and Pop's house and have Christmas dinner with my uncle Rick, my auntie and all of my cousins. All of the adults drink a lot of beer and Prosecco. Because I have a big family, we have Christmas on Boxing Day too, and we go to my granddad's to have dinner. We get more presents and we see the rest of my family. The best bit is that mummy and daddy are off work, so I get to see them a lot over the Christmas period. That was from Harry Morris. I just want to say that The Santa Claus is also one of my favourite Christmas movies. So next we've got a couple of stories from children at Stockport Grammar School, and this one is from Umair. Christmas this year won't be the same because of that Boris Johnson. Short and to the point. Lastly, we have a story from Stanley Toombs. A time to be together. Christmas will be different for everyone this year. Families are spread across several households, travel is restricted, and even if we do meet up, we can't hug, shake hands, or even play board games. But for me, Christmas will be different for another reason, because we lost my granddad a few weeks ago. He was the best granddad in the world, and I'm so sad that he's not with us anymore. He used to help me with so many things, it's really hard to imagine a world without him. So this Christmas, I'll be thinking of him and remembering what a lovely, kind and funny man he was. Even though it's a horrible time for us, we can use a festive season to be thankful for the times we had and enjoy the memories. And I just want to give a little message to Stanley to say that I also lost my granddad this year, and I know it's really sad, but I think your story is a lovely message of how we can remember them over the Christmas period instead of being sad that they're not with us. So thank you for that. I really enjoyed reading these stories and I really hope you enjoyed listening to them. So have a lovely Christmas, and if you can donate to Wood Street Mission, then please do.
Hello everybody, so my name's Karen Henthorn and I'm delighted to have been asked to read a story to help raise funds for a fantastic charity in Greater Manchester, the Wood Street Mission. I hope you enjoy this story. Thank you. Oh, the details are on the bottom of the screen all the way through. Home from Home by Richard Morris. Danielle tore open the plastic bag. She'd waited 11 months for this, and the bag had been thrown into a drawer after she picked it up for 75p in January. Not a lot of need for Christmas stock at the start of a new year, but she'd looked ahead. Besides, the orange formica tabletop wasn't very festive, so it would make a difference, she hoped. The paper tablecloth folded out. She saw that the pattern of holly went right around the edges. She suspected that it would just be in the bit that you could see through the plastic. Well, after all, the pound shop that she brought it from could be a bit dodgy sometimes. So that was, she thought, maybe a bonus, that she hadn't been duped out of her money. It was a relief. She flung the paper over the orange formica table. Oh, Maybe not so good. No. It hadn't said how big it was. It just said festive tablecloth on the bag. So it was a relief that the pattern went all the way around, but it was a disappointment that it didn't really cover the table. Oh well, you can't have everything, she thought. No matter, I've made an effort, and that's the main thing. Shall I leave the orange formica at both ends, or just the orange formica at one end? Maybe I could sit there. Sit at that end. I don't mind not having a tablecloth. No, no, that was the wrong word. A table paper at my end. It's my gig, so I should take that hardship. Still, it would have looked better if all of the orange formica had been covered. Just for a change. Just so that it just felt better, you know, a bit more Christmassy. Anyway, no matter. I'll take the orange end. Anyway, I'm cooking, I'm serving up, so I'll be at the table less than the others. So, all in all, it's the best solution. I wanted this to be special. Of course I did. Away from the humdrum. Although I wasn't sure they'd appreciate it. You know, the extra effort, that is. A tablecloth, well, a table paper, holly, all the way around, not just on the bit I knew was there because I saw it through the plastic bag. You know, worth the planning. Maybe after Christmas this time, I'll be a little bit more careful what to buy from the pound shop. But the food is the most important thing. Of course it is. That's the point. It's important not to be humdrum. Like it was every other day of the year. Well, almost every other day of the year. And besides, there'll be other things on the table, brightening it up, paper hats, Christmas crackers. Oh, more paper. Why is it that everything at Christmas, on the table for Christmas dinner, is paper? Because, of course, it's disposable. No need for hats and crackers for the rest of the year. Just this special day. Danielle stood back. She admired her work. Adjusted the layout. Napkins. Red ones. She hadn't bought them specially. Well, maybe she had, but that was ages ago, years ago. But they always come in packs of 50, don't they? Did she buy these at the pound shop? She couldn't remember. Maybe. But she laid them out carefully. Hat, cracker, napkin. 8 times. There would still be 30 napkins left. Hats and crackers went in the bin afterwards. So, if there were 50 in the pack to start with, she'd taken 8 out each year for 3 years. Or was it 4? Doesn't matter. It doesn't matter because there was still plenty left for next year. If she had to set places for 8 next year. She never knew. She never knew from year to year. And let's face it, not everybody turns up who's been invited. Although most do. It's difficult to tell. Anyway, she brought 8 paper hats, packs of 4, and 12 crackers, packs of 12. They always seem to be in packs of 12. Packs of 10 sometimes. Never, never packs of 8 or 6 or even 4. 10 was optimistic. 12 was, well, I mean, how many people have 12 for Christmas dinner? Anyway, if everybody turned up, there'd be 4 crackers left and she could save them for next year. Although that would mean buying another pack of, the sums just didn't add up. They all turned up. First, Pete Sharkey. Nobody ever really knew why Pete was called Sharky, not even Pete. And then Dave, well, Dave and Kirsty, together. They always seem to arrive together. Come to think of it, they always seem to leave together. Jimmy, Ronnie, Daniel, they always call him Dan because it's confusing. That's why they call him Dan and not me. Although that doesn't help much. Of course, Dopey was last. I mean, he always was. That's not why they call him Dopey. It's because once he found somebody sleeping in his bed and somebody said he was like one of the seven dwarves, finding somebody in his bed, I mean. Well, they had a vote which one to call him and everybody agreed that Dopey was the best name, the one that suited him best. So Dopey stuck. Anyway, it was good that everyone turned up. Always good that you can rely on people. And they appreciated the table, the table paper and the hats. And people just get silly on Christmas Day, don't they? I mean, they'd never walk around with a silly hat on any other day. Although, come to think of it, Sharky wears a silly hat most of the time. Well, but that's because he's bald and he doesn't like it. Well, I guess nobody likes it, being bald, I mean. But he's just so sensitive. I mean, he's very sensitive about lots of things. I mean, whenever anybody asks him about his family or what he did for a living, he just looks away and mumbles something. I'm not surprised. Not really. I know he misses them. And I know it wasn't really his fault. But he'll never talk about it, even though I'm sure it would do him good to talk about it. I mean. And Jimmy, Jimmy never shuts up about things. I mean, you don't have to ask him. In fact, he bores the pants off everybody about where he's been, what he's done, how he could have had this, that and the other. I'm not sure anybody believes him, well, apart from Ronnie, who sort of looks up to him as some sort of father figure, I guess. That a big part of that is that Ronnie never knew his dad. Although between you and me, I know that he did. It's just easier to say that he never knew him. You know, it's more convenient. I think it's only because Jimmy's older than him. You know, not old enough to be his dad, I mean. Just older. That he looks up to him. And of course, Jimmy never shuts up telling him what to do because he never shuts up about anything. Always giving advice. As if he can. Not really. And Daniel, not me, well, he's quiet too, but deep. He smiles a lot, and he can be very funny. He picks his moments. It's like when Dave and Kirsty said they were going out to get something to eat one day, and when they got back, he asked them if they'd been for a pot canoodle. Everybody laughed. But it was a good joke. Well, Dave and Kirsty, well, they always seem to be together, so. Although I do know that Kirsty worries about bumping into her husband or ex-boyfriend or whatever it is. I guess Dave worries about that too, though he'd never admit it. And Sharky is just Sharky. You know, always trying to sell you something. Maybe I've just thought of this. Maybe that's why his name's Sharky. You know, daft things that nobody would ever want. Last week, it was a radio that you could play in a shower. Well, everybody said he wouldn't know whether it was waterproof or not because he hadn't had a shower for years. Still in the box. No idea where he got it from. He wanted a fiver. Well, nobody wanted it, even when he dropped the price to £3. Anyway. They all turned up, which was great. Nobody brought anything though. I thought they might, you know, just some mince pies or something. I mean, I had a bit of help buying everything, but it still cost me a few quid. I did the whole lot. Wasn't scrimping. Everybody had a turkey slice. And roast potatoes and carrots. And I didn't get the sprouts from Iceland. No, I bought them fresh on the market. Well, that's not strictly true. Charlie, who has the veg stall, well, I offered to pay him and he just said, you can have them. Merry Christmas. It's good of him, really. Really good. And I did the Christmas pudding in the microwave and it was okay. Microwaved the custard too. And everybody really enjoyed it. Of course it got a bit rowdy. Well, I think that's what happens when you have a good meal and you're all wearing silly hats. And Jimmy is going on and on. And Dan taking the mickey out of him in his own way. You know, just one-liners. Well, Jimmy was going on about losing a game of cards for really big stakes. Because this other guy was cheating. And he was going on and on about losing big stakes. And Dan just said to him, I bet you really wanted that Mars bar. It's funny. Funny. I see most of them almost every day. And a lot of the time, we do have some grub together. We even sit at this table a lot of the time, depending on who turns up, you know. They're a good crew. Characters. I don't usually cook for them though. Just Christmas dinner. It's my speciality, you know, everybody knows that. Can't remember how many times I've done it now. But I guess I could count the napkins, see how many are left in the pack of 50, and I'd be able to work it out. Anyway, the other thing is that nobody helped me to wash up. They never do. It's like they never bring mince pies. And that's okay. Cooking for friends, it's good. Even if it is only for one day of the year. Dave and Kirsty left first, together. Well, not exactly together. Kirsty left and then Dave left a couple of minutes later. I guess Kirsty might have been seeing if the coast was clear. You know, I don't know. By the time they'd all gone, I had plenty of time to wash up. You know, straighten everything, make sure everything was ship-shape, whatever ship-shape means. I even found a Tupperware in the cupboard and put what was left into it, you know, to take with me, a takeaway. I separated the last bit of Christmas pudding, of course, and I wrapped it in a bit of tin foil so it didn't taste of sprouts. I just waited then a little while until John came to lock up. He said thanks for leaving everything clean and tidy. He said he had something in the car for me. So I waited while he pulled the shutter down and locked up. And then he went over to his car and he took two tins of Foster's off the passenger seat and gave them to me. It was really kind. I wished him a happy Christmas and he said that he was going to have to go off and have a drink himself now, you know, a drink with his family, because he hadn't been able to have one all day, what with having to come and drive, you know, to lock up. It was really kind of him. It's not far to the block of flats. It's just a 5-minute walk. Though it was very cold out there. Still, since the flats have been empty, the rubbish chute is a really good place. You know what I mean? Once you've pulled the door shut, it's not very drafty. And I've managed to build a sort of wall that I can put up against the inside of the door, you know, a wall of cardboard. And I still have enough left to lie on, so there's plenty spare. It's quite cosy, really. And quiet. I've got a sort of confession to make. When Sharky couldn't sell the shower radio, he left it behind. He must have forgotten about it, so I borrowed it. It's still working. The batteries, they last for ages. It's been a good day. Thank you, everybody. I really hope you enjoyed that fantastic story. I'd like to wish you all a very, very happy Christmas. And if you can carry on supporting Wood Street Mission, I know they really, really appreciate all the toys and the donations that have been given so far. So keep up the good work, everybody. Have a great Christmas and take good care of each other. Oh, and the details are at the top.